Welcome to our Crossing Archive. My name is Joey Harris, and I'm the online minister here at The Crossing. Here's where you can find all of our full services from our Crossing online experience. We are continuing our series this week called Stranger Stronger. It's all about making your relationships better. This week, Jerry Harris, our senior pastor, is going to be teaching us all about purity. But before we get into the sermon, we've got some incredible worship for you. Thanks for watching.
You are my shepherd guiding me. You give me everything I need. Oh, I know that you love me. You lay me down in pastures green. You lead me by the quiet streams. Oh, I know that you love me. Jesus, you are good and your love. Shelter, I'm secure. Jesus, you are good, and your mercy's new. Every moment of my life, I will dwell in your house forever. Though I may walk in valleys deep, I stand in the midst of enemies. My soul. chain will break as broken hearts declare His praise. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? And our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. And our God is the Lamb, the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Set captives. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain. Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him.
Good morning, Crossing Church. How's everybody doing today? You doing all right? You look like you're ready to have church. I am too. It's exciting. And I want to welcome all the campuses that are joining with us all throughout this region in four states. We are so thankful that you're joining with us. Everyone that's online, .tv, Crossing Inside, being able to connect with you in a virtual way, that is also a great blessing. And we're really thankful that you're joining with us, that we have the opportunity to join with you. Last week, we had Clayton on the stage, and he was talking about being stranger and stronger with regards to forgiveness and how that becomes a key that unlocks so much in our lives. I'm so thankful for him delivering that message and doing it in such a great way. Hey, a little bit later, you're going to see something that's awesome. We had a leak in our baptistry in Hannibal. And I mean, it was really bad. It had been bad a while. It had rotted out the wood underneath. So they had taken it all apart and they were trying to get it back together before the last weekend, and they didn't get it done in time. They couldn't do it. There was a lot of other problems, and they had 10 people that wanted to be baptized. So you're going to see in the video at the end those 10 people getting baptized in the Mississippi River. Oh my! It's going to look like they're kind of being baptized and electrocuted at the same time. Kind of looks that way. But I got to tell you guys in Hannibal, you are teaching us commitment. That is commitment. That is awesome. Hannah, and a shout out to 929. We did a superhero thing at Barry Ann School last night and connected with the community. And I hope there's a ton of you at the 1045 service. We are so glad that we get the opportunity to connect with you as well. So last week, we talked about stranger and stronger with regards to forgiveness. This week, we're going to talk about another issue where we really look strange, but it'll make us incredibly strong. And this is the issue of purity. Now, purity can involve a lot of different things. It can involve what you say, what you hear, what you see, what you touch. But a lot of times when we think about purity, we go to the idea of sexual purity. And I'm going to spend the majority of my time talking about that. And I want to tell you, this is an incredibly powerful component of being stranger and stronger. So if we're going to talk about purity, the first thing we need to know is, well, what does it mean? When we talk about purity, what does it mean? Actually, it means two things, okay? And the first one is consistency. If something is pure, it's consistent. Now, this is what I mean by that. It means that you are the same on the inside as you are on the, you can say it, as you are on the, that's right, the same on the inside as on the outside. It means that you are the same when you're with this group of people or that group of people. It means that you're the same if you're out in public or if you're at home alone. It means that you're always the same. That means there's a consistency about you. Now, when I think of consistency, this is what I think of. I think of this product. This is Ivory soap. And I don't know how many of you might remember this, but when Ivory soap has been sold, one of the and I have no idea how they come up with this, but they say Ivory soap, there's actually a mathematical equation for its purity. They say it is 99.44% pure. I don't know about that. I just know I like soap. I'm not one of those weird, you know, bath gel kind of guys. I'm a soap guy, and it makes you smell good. Anyway, so Ivory soap is pure, and I am also cheap. I don't know how many of you are cheap, but I'm cheap, because when I start on this bar of soap, I love a new bar of soap. How many of you love a new bar of soap? Yeah, okay, but I'm going to work this sucker down until it is a sliver. How many of you do that? Like, and it breaks in half, and you still try to use both halves. I want you to be honest right now, okay? Okay, because that's cheap. You are cheap, like me. Okay, anyway, I'm not breaking out the new soap. I can get one more shower out of that. Now, okay, so I'm going to cut this and make a mess up here. There goes my mess. They will clean it up later. But it's the same. It's just a bar of soap. And it's the same on the outside as it is on the inside. Now, what's the problem with that? Well, there's no problem with the soap. The problem's with me. The problem's with you. Because when you look at yourself and look at your neighbor, just look at your neighbor right now. Oh, yeah, see what I'm talking about? Anyway, what do you know? That we are not consistent, are we? We're very inconsistent. Now, that isn't because we don't want to be consistent. How many of you want to be consistent in your life? Like, you want to have this, you want to be that person. You want to be the person that doesn't have any hypocrisy in you, that you're just the same on the inside and out, and it's all good. It's not bad, but it's all good. You want to be that person. I want to be the person. I think that's something we would all like to be, but it is not, honestly, something that we are. The second component, it sounds very much like the first, but the second component to purity is a substance component. You know what that means? It means that you're comprised of just one thing. Like, there's not a lot of different things. It's just one thing. And there's no foreign material there. There's no stuff in there that really doesn't belong there. So I want to illustrate that, okay? I want to illustrate what that this idea of substance is and how important actually that is to us. And I'm going to do that with candy bars. Okay, so I have three volunteers that have somebody pre-selected before the service. I have no idea who they are. I want you to come up here, and you're going to be my candy bar people. Who are you? Come on up right now. And I want you to be thinking, there's one, there's two. Where's number three? There we go. All right, come on up, come on. All right, and what I'm going to have you do is stay. I want you to stand right here in front of this really cool thing that we're going to be using later. How are you doing? Jerry, Stacy,
Brittany,
Denise, how are you doing?
Good.
You look like you're having a good day. You know what make your day better? Candy. Candy always makes your day better. You may have had a difficult time, like getting up this morning, getting ready this morning. Maybe you had kids trying, you know, and it can make life difficult, but you just get a sugar rush and things get better, right? So I have three. I have a Butterfinger, a Snickers, and a Kit Kat bar. So who's a Snickers person? No, oh, okay, first hand up. Okay, Kit Kat. Okay, you're first. You're Butterfinger. Are you okay with it? All right, all right, all right. So, I mean, those are like the full-size candy bars. Those are the great candy bars. Looking pretty good. All right, this is gonna be it's gonna be good. Okay, so here's what I want you to do. I want you to open up your candy bar. And then I want you to take the candy bar completely out of the wrapper. How you doing? How many of you wish you had a Kit Kat right now?
I know.
Yeah, we're not giving you anything. So because you're, you know, okay. Have you got it? Oh, yeah. Is it? Well, bring it, both pieces. Because that happens with Butterfingers. Butterfingers break. How many of you know that? Yeah, that's true. All right. You got both pieces out. Very good. Oh, yeah, you're good. You could do that. I mean, whatever. All right. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to take a nice big bite of your candy bar. I'm going to say that was a lame bite for the Snickers. That was like one corner. How many of you can take a bite and like take a half a candy bar in one bite? All right. I'm just kidding. I'm sorry. Anyway, that's good. How is it? How's it going for you? You feeling the rush? Everything's getting better. Look, you're smiling. It's good. It's great. You're doing such a good job. Now, here's what I want you to do now. I want you to rewrap it. Oh, you wadded it up. Okay, just do your best. Do your very best to rewrap it. You're doing fine. That's okay. Don't worry. That's fine. It's a Butterfinger. It happens.
It's a little sticky.
It's a little sticky. Yeah, I get that. I get that. You got that one? That looks good. Look at that. Look at that. You can hardly tell. There's only like a little teeny chunk out of that. That was good. Okay. Okay, that's not quite as good. But, and here's another. Okay. All right. If I had some tape or some staples maybe. Oh, that's okay. Like you can hardly tell. Thank you. Thank you very much. You can go ahead and sit down. I was just, you know. Thank you very much. Yes, give him a hand. Okay, Now, I have three candy bars. Who would like to have some candy? You are a sick dude. That's what I'm just going to tell you. You're sick. How many of you think it would be gross to eat this candy bar now? And why is that? Because, I mean, yeah, they were very nice young ladies, but that's cooties, man. That's just cooties. You know? It's like, you know, they took it out of the wrapper, they were holding it, you know, and then after they were holding it, you know, they put it in their mouth, they chewed on it, and they put it back in. Some of you are going, I can turn that sucker around, and I can start on the other side. How many of you are thinking that? Yeah, I look at you. You're sick. All right, what's my point? This is my point, is that when we're talking about purity, particularly sexual purity, isn't it a lot like that candy bar where we take it out of the wrapper and we have some and then we put it back in the wrapper and we try to rewrap it and make it look like everything's the same as it was when it really isn't the same as it was? And here's the crazy thing. In the world, the culture is telling you that's perfectly fine. Right? Tell me something. Why does it gross you out when you're talking about something as unimportant as a candy bar, but when you're talking about something as important as our sexuality, it doesn't gross you out? Has the world got into our head enough that we actually think that it isn't strange? You see, in the world, if you're going to live according to the rules of the Lord that He's laid out in His Word, you're going to protect your sexual purity, right? You're going to protect that. And the world is going to look at you and go, there's something majorly wrong with you. There's something strange about you because that's just not how we do it in the world. But what I would submit to you is what is actually happening is what the world is calling us to do is really strange. What the world is calling us to do is gross. It is not cool. And if you do it the way that God wants you to do it, it'll make you stronger. It really will, right? I mean, really, this is gross. This is gross. This is like going to the theater and pulling off somebody else's gum off the bottom of your seat and putting it in your mouth. Why did he have to say that? It's gross. You know, living strange is getting a lot more difficult as the generations go forward. We've talked to you about generations. In my generation, I mean, living according to the Lord was strange, but not at the level it is now. Let me just give you one illustration of that. I'm a baby boomer, and most of my friends were getting married somewhere between 18 and 22. Is that connecting with some of you? Some of them got married right out of high school. Some of them got married, I mean, they were waiting to graduate from college. Just get college over with, and then it's kind of like go to work and get married. And that's kind of where we started our lives our married lives at 22, right? But today we're living in a world that's a lot different than that. Millennials have a different view, and a lot of that has been presented to them by their parents. Like millennials' parents are saying to them, you know what you need to do? You need to go to get done with high school, then get done with college, and then you need to kind of figure out who you are and what you want to do, and you're going to have all of this school debt, and you're really not going to be settled in on a career. And so the parents of millennials are encouraging their kids to get married around 28, 29, or 30 years old. And here's the interesting thing. Millennials are agreeing with them. They're going, yeah, that's probably a good idea. So I'll wait till I'm 28, 29, or 30 years old. And some of you right now are going, what's the problem with that? I'll tell you what the problem is. That puberty happens around 12 or 13. Some younger, maybe some a little older, right? Which means that if I believe in sexual purity and I get married when I'm 21, I've had to hold on to that purity and that chastity for 8, 7, 8, 9 years. And that is a marathon. I don't know about girls, but for guys, that's a marathon. 7, 8, or 9 years, okay? Just imagine if you had to tack another 9 onto it. Oh yeah, we're expecting you to remain sexually pure for 18 years. How many people are going, that's nuts. How am I supposed to do that? Here's what I really want you to see. I'm not trying to say that's okay or not okay. What I'm trying to say is this. I'm saying that we're putting our college education, we're putting our economic situation, we're talking about our school bill or our career or seeing the world. We're putting all of that at the top of the list. And where are we putting purity? Oh, we're putting it down here, like it's not that important. Both parents and, right? Are you hearing me? Without ever addressing the fact of what might happen, you know what might be? It might be important to get married earlier. Biblically, it says it's better to marry than to burn in passion. You see, if you're going to live according to the rules of this world, then it's going to take God's rules, God's, not. It's more than advice. This is how life is done, God's way, and it's going to put it at the bottom of the list, and it's going to put the world's way at the top of the list. And you might think that's going to work, but it's not. And what ends up happening is it defines what is more valuable to us, and that's the wrong things. And we need to learn to look at it in a different way. That's what I want to do right now. I want to look at it at a different way, in a different way. And the way I'm going to do that is I have another volunteer somewhere out in this audience. I don't know who it is, but they're going to enjoy a homemade organic omelet. Who's going to come up here and do that? Who's our omelet person? Oh, yeah, come on up here. I am going to make you a homemade omelet on stage in front of all these people. Do you like eggs, first of all? What's your name? Josh. Josh, come on back around here to the back with me, okay? I'm going to turn this up a little bit. Needs to be a little bit hotter probably. And what we have here is we have eggs, right? You can tell they're well whisked. See that? Look at that. Well whisked. You can bring it on in here, man. Okay. And what we're going to do is we're going to kick it up, okay? So here's what I've got. I've got bacon. How do you go wrong with that, right? Because like that was what was on the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was bacon, you know, obviously. And we have not just ham, but we have Black Forest Bavarian ham. And we have green peppers and we have green onions. You know, if you want to get a little bit of that edge to it, you know, that's kind of good. And of course, cheese. Cheese. Can't go wrong with cheese. So here's what I want to know. You can't have any of the candy bars. No candy bars. Okay, so here, yeah, just get that out of your head. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to, like, whatever ingredients are your favorite, I want you to, you can just put your hand right in there and grab those ingredients. They're completely, yes, no one's touched them before you. He goes to the bacon first. You are a man. All right, anyway. Oh, yeah, that's how we roll. Oh, yeah, then the green peppers, and then, yeah, you don't even, do you want, I mean, you can do more cheese if you want. I mean, if you just want, yeah, that's it. That's what you want. Your green peppers, and you put a tiny little bit of the onion in there, just a little bit, yeah. That's looking good. That's looking really good. Good choices. So you go over here and sit, and I'm going to start in. Are you ready? You're watching me? All right. Now, this is going to not exactly be like totally an omelet. It's going to be a little bit of scramble. Because I'm just not good at doing that whole fold-over thing. So I feel like I'm on the Today Show right now. It's kind of, it's kind of, look at that. It's just perfect. You smelling that?
I'm watching it.
You're watching it, but you're not smelling it? It's not coming to you over there? How's that? Ooh, yes. Yes. Okay. So I'm going to work this here a little bit. How many of you are getting hungry right now? There was a person on Thursday night that after they saw this and they were the person that came up, they go, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go home right now and I'm going to make myself another omelet because it was that good. I want you to know that there's special stuff in here and it's like not bad stuff, like half and half, you know, just to give it like that extra, kick it up a notch. Are you guys getting hungry yet? Man, that smells good. I'm going to give it a little bit of time. You getting hungry yet?
It's a neat little package there.
Yeah, I got it. It is a neat little package. Neat little package. And so, how do you like coming to church and having an omelet?
It's pretty fantastic.
How many of you want an omelet right now? Forget you. It's not going to happen. Okay, we're getting pretty close. We're getting pretty close with the omelet. I know look at that. Check that out. Yeah, little garnishes. You're on fine china. Got a napkin. Do you use a napkin?
At the end.
Okay. All right. Well, I think you're ready. Man, that is looking serious. Bon appetit. Give that a try. See how that works for you. Get a big bite. Hope I got it done enough. It's good? Fantastic? Oh, yeah. Okay. Give me one more. Give me one more bite. Oh, yeah. Those are man bites right there. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, wait a minute. I forgot. You know, I told you it's a little hot. Sorry, I have no drink. I told you it was like a totally organic omelet, and this is like very rare. This is very special and very rare. And I want to put this on here because it's like a really secret ingredient.
Pretty sure that's dirt.
What'd you say? You're pretty sure that's dirt? Well, actually, it's not. It's not dirt. What it is there's actually a term for it. It's called chicken dust. And what it is like when chickens lay, where they, you know, they bathe in the dust. They like get down and bathe in the dust, and they make this really fine. What? They make this really fine dirt. It's totally organic. There are no GMOs. So go ahead. Just eat around it if you don't.
Yeah, I'm gonna find a piece over here.
No, don't even do it. Don't even do it. You can go sit down. Thanks, Josh. I appreciate it. Don't even do it. You know what I've appreciated? In the last two services, I actually had to talk them out of taking another bite because they're just trying so hard to do what I ask them to do. What did I just do? I ruined this perfectly good omelet by putting this dirt, not just dirt, but something way worse than that, on this omelet. I'll tell you what I'm trying to tell you is that we tend to want to compartmentalize our lives. Like we want to say, like over here, I have this set of rules, but in over here, I'll have another set of rules. And we'll think like, well, I can be pure over here, and then I can be impure over here. We do that in our lives. We compartmentalize. But the truth is, look, some impurity affects purity as a whole. Right? A little bit of impurity makes you impure. And it looks like he's trying to make me feel better, but you just put chicken dust on my omelet. Right? The world tells us that we can compartmentalize our lives and it'll be just fine. It'll be okay. But will it be okay? The Bible gives us a completely different answer to that. And I'm going to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. The Apostle Paul says these words. He says, flee from sexual immorality. All other sins, listen to this, all other sins a man commits are outside of his body, but he who sins sexually sins against his own body. What he's doing there is he's differentiating. He's saying there's all these sins, all other sins, and then there's this one. I mean, I know some of you would say, oh, all sins the same. Well, the Bible doesn't actually say that. Not here, right? In some respects they are, in others they're not. Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you've received from God? You're not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. What is Paul teaching us here under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit? This, sexual sin messes with your hardwiring. It messes with who you actually are and who God intended you to be. Sexual sin messes that up. And when we try to compartmentalize our lives, or we try to say, well, you know, I know there's some bad substance there, but I'm just going to make believe like it's not there and try to rewrap the candy bar. You know, whatever it is, we're lying to ourselves. Now, before you think all that I'm doing is just trying to get a lot of people up at the steps, Like, man, I really feel bad now. He got me because this problem and that problem, and I just compartmentalized. No, that's not what I want to do. I think it'd be great if we had the steps full today, but that's not the issue. The issue is I want to give you hope. I want you to have hope. You know, some of us at these locations, we don't have anybody else to blame but ourselves when it comes to impurity. Some of us don't have ourselves to blame at all. Some of you are victims. Some of you are abused, pre-adolescently abused. Some of you were abused in adolescence. Some of you have been abused sexually in your marriages. There's been a lot of abuse that's going on. You may be victimized here, and you're saying, you know, I'm dealing with this sexual impurity thing, but it wasn't my fault. I didn't do that. Somebody did that to me. Some of you are here, one of our locations, you're the perpetrator. And some of you are neither a victim or a perpetrator. You just went by the world's rules. And so here you are, and you're dealing with this issue of impurity, right? So we can't rewind the clock, can we? Or can we? I told you I wanted to give you hope. Check this out. My God invented time. So just because something happened before in my life doesn't mean that God can't do something miraculous with regards to time. And my God invented sexuality. So even though something has happened to me in my life or I've allowed things to happen in my life, God is greater than both time and sexuality. I'm going to tell you something else about God. He is a healer. God is a healer. And I don't think we understand the extent to which God heals. I want you to look at 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. Jesus' best friend, John, writes this. He says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins. Look at this. Look at this word. And what? Purify. Purify. Purify us. Now look at this phrase right here. I love it. Purify us from all unrighteousness. All of it. Well, that's what I need. See, my problem is consistency. My problem is substance. My problem is compartmentalization. That's who I am. I have this, and when I try to turn over a new leaf, the leaf looks the same on the both sides. You know what I'm talking about? I'm not pure. I'm impure. So the only way that I can be pure is for someone to impart that purity to me, because I don't have it on my own, right? You need to memorize that scripture, not just read it. Because my God is able to cleanse me from all sins. That's why the scripture says if anyone is in Christ, he is what? A new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. He is able to turn back the clock. He's able to rewire me. He's able to do what I could never do on my own. With my lack of will and my lack of consistency, he is consistent and he imparts that purity to me. God is stronger, and that means that we're stronger, and it's because he's in us, not because of us. Now, I want to quickly give you some action steps, okay? Because you may be going, oh, what do I do? How do I handle this? Number one, own it. Just own it. You know, it's amazing how we tend to want to make excuses and we want to rationalize, you know, our behavior, or we want to compare ourselves to other people and say, well, I'm not as bad as they are. Like we do that rather than just own it. Just take it in and say, yeah, that's who I am. Now, let me tell you how you know if you've owned it. You know if you've owned it if it hurts. If it hurts, if it makes you shed tears, if it makes you sad, that's how you know. And if it's not doing that to you, then there's some of that rationalization or excusing or comparison that's going on. You need to drop all that and just own it, okay? Like I said, there's two parts to this. Make a decision, and that decision is own it and then realize that only Jesus can change you. You can't change yourself. You try and try, but you can't change yourself. And let me tell you something about change. Change doesn't happen quickly. It takes time. And it takes repeated failure. And that's okay. because he who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete that work. That's who Jesus is. And let me tell you something about doing stuff. Anything worth doing is worth doing poorly. Whoever was an expert at anything the first time they tried? Right? So, own it. Make a decision and own it. Let Jesus help you. Then, remove it and then replace it. Remove and replace. You don't want an empty void in your life. Satan takes advantage of empty places in your life. So when you're getting rid of something, when God is pushing something out to purify you in your life, fill it with a good thing. Fill it with a God thing. So keep your life full, because that empty space can be a very dangerous space. And then just keep repeating that process. Just keep on repeating that process. Some of you might say, why doesn't Jesus just take this away from me? I have this issue. I always seem to have this issue. I always go back to this issue. Why can't I just trust God to just take it all away? And he doesn't take it all away. Because you learn more about Jesus in the struggle than you do in the absence of it. Are you hearing me? You learn in the midst of the struggle, not in the absence of it. No one, none of us, all of our locations, everyone watching is exempt from this. We're all in the same boat. I want to close with this. You know, Matthew 5, 6, and 7 is the Sermon on the Mount. It begins, Jesus begins that sermon with what we call the Beatitudes. And in the Beatitudes, he talks about purity. You know what he says? He says, blessed are the pure in heart. And do you know the blessing you get from this? Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. They'll see him. You're never going to find that purity if you're looking for it inside yourself. It has to come from outside yourself. Because there was only one pure person that ever walked the face of this earth, just one, and that was Jesus Christ. And when he died on the cross for your sins, there was something absolutely pure that happened in that moment, and that was the blood that he bled was absolutely pure, and it is sufficient. The purity of his blood, his perfect blood, has the ability to cleanse us from all of our sin. It's not 99 and 44, 100% pure. It is absolutely pure because it was the blood of God. Only Jesus can purify you. And he will do that if you let him today. We're moving to a time of decision.
This is one of those sermons that you just really don't want to hear. You're listening and you know you're guilty, and being called out on it isn't something you're interested in. Purity, specifically in sexual sin, is perfectly fine hiding in the dark of your heart where no one can see it. Sexual sin, it's like being in a dark room for a long time. Your eyes just get used to the dark. Then someone walks in the door and flips on the lights and you're like, hey, that hurts, quit it, turn the lights back off. But that's not what God calls us to. Ephesians 5 says, but everything exposed by the light becomes visible, and everything that is illuminated becomes a light. Today, right now, is a time to turn the dark room of your heart into a light. Take the sins that you've been hiding from God, from your family, from your friends, and instead give it to God, who can turn it into light. He can use your past as a way to reach more people. Maybe, just maybe, if you give that sin up to God, that person at work that you've been trying to reach sees you owning that sin, and he confides in you that he's been dealing with the same thing. Maybe God uses the sexual abuse you experienced to help women escape the same abuse and lead them to Christ. Everybody deals with purity. No one is exempt from it. The question is, what are you going to do with it? Are you going to get angry and yell, hey, turn the lights off, and stay there? Or are you going to keep the light on and let God use your life to impact the world? Let's go to him right now.
Drawing us to Christ, bearing
to our feet. Grace and streams of mercy covering. Every guilt and shame are washed away in you now.
Thank you.
purity isn't just about sexual sin. There's a million things that can corrupt your heart. The world is full of them. What we need is something to wash away all those things from our lives, to clean the muck of this world, to keep us different, to keep us strange. Hebrews 10:10 says, "And by that will we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all." Jesus loved you so much, he died on a cross for your sins so that you can have an intimate, personal relationship with him. That's what this time is for right now, to spend time with your Heavenly Father, thanking him for that sacrifice, taking communion, which represents his body and blood, and cleansing yourself through that sacrifice. That's what makes us pure and holy. So together, let's spend some time with him right now. Thanks for watching. We hope you enjoyed our service. You can join us live at thecrossing.tv on Thursdays at 6 p.m. and Sundays at 9 a.m. and 10:45 a.m. all in the Central Time Zone. If you have any questions, you can always contact me at joeyh@thecrossing.net. Next week, we are going to continue our series, Stranger, Stronger, and you won't want to miss out. Thanks for watching.